Good morning. Welcome to Lakewood United Methodist Church. I'm glad you've chosen to worship with us today. We have two flower arrangements. I'd like to tell you about them. One of them is given to the glory of God by Jackie and Fred Garnon in honor of their grandchildren. Thank you for sharing. The other one is given to the glory of God by Betty and Don Adams in honor of their daughter, Kathy Fisher's birthday. Happy birthday, Kathy. Please join with me now in the call to worship. I am the vine, you are the branches, says the Lord.
Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit.
We gather to worship that our spirits may be nourished.
We depart praying that our lives may bear much fruit.
Please join me in prayer. God of love, plant us in the soil of your grace. Nurture us with the strength of Christ, the vine of everlasting life. Enlighten us with the wisdom of your Spirit, which flows through us today and all days. Abide in us, that we may abide in you and live in your love. In your holy name we pray. Amen. The first lesson comes from the letter known as 1 John. I'm reading in chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. The word of the Lord. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and God's love is made complete in us. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now let us sing as we welcome the children for the children's sermon. Good morning, boys and girls. Thank you for joining me. How many of you like to eat grapes? Would you like to have a handful of them? Can you see that? Grapes are sweet and juicy, and I bought some. Would you like to try some? You don't think those look like grapes? No, they don't. They're kind of dried up. It looks like these grapes fell off the vine and onto the ground, and they've shriveled up. Do you know what we call these? They're called raisins. And yes, you can still eat them, but our lesson this morning is about grapes. Grapes are supposed to be full and lush and big like that, not all shriveled up. Jesus makes the point that if we fall off the vine, if we're not connected to Him, then spiritually we'll dry up, when instead He wants us to be full of His love. So it's so important that we remain connected to the vine, who is Jesus, so that our lives can bear fruit that will make the world a better place. Not just good, juicy grapes, but the love of Christ. Let us pray. Jesus, You are the vine, and we are the branches. Help us to bear fruit, Your love, in Your name. Amen. Have a great week, and thanks for joining me. Bye now. Gospel according to John. I'm in chapter 15, reading verses 1 through 8. Hear the word of the Lord. Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. The word of life. Thanks be to God. It's fascinating to me that in our Protestant religious culture, there is a strong emphasis upon the literal interpretation of the Bible. Now, I take the Bible seriously, but not literally. Interestingly, Jesus did not always speak literally, but he often spoke figuratively. He spoke in allegories or images. He painted word pictures. Instead of literally coming out and saying what he meant, he would often tell a story and let people come to their own conclusion. Indeed, these hidden messages would frequently frustrate his disciples, and they wished that Jesus would speak more literally and not be so subtle. Well, this morning we look at one of the I am sayings of Jesus. This morning we hear him say, I am the vine. I am the true vine. Now, even the most ardent fundamentalist has to agree that when Jesus spoke these words, he was not speaking literally. It was an image. Like last week when we heard Jesus say, I am the good shepherd, and you are the sheep of my flock. None of us grow wool, and all of us speak the English language. We're not walking around saying, bah, bah, right? So it was an image. It wasn't meant to be taken literally. Now, when Jesus spoke about vineyards, the people of Judea could immediately relate to what he was talking about. It was an industry that had been carefully cultivated throughout the country for centuries. And it was crucial because it was a cash crop. It generated revenue as opposed to grain, which was grown for consumption. Grapes were how people made their money. A vineyard was the symbol of the nation of Israel. Now in America, we might think of amber waves of grain, but in Judea, they thought of their nation as a vineyard. It was a kind of national identity. Over and over again in the Old Testament, Israel is pictured as the vine or the vineyard of the Lord. Now, in this analogy that Jesus used, he likened himself to a vine, while the fruit-bearing branches are his disciples. God, the farmer, is depicted as the one who cultivates the vineyard. He waters and tends the soil so the vine is properly nourished. The farmer also prunes the vines and removes the dead wood to make room for healthy new growth. The farmer takes pride in his crop. What Jesus is saying is pretty clear. The disciples should receive their strength through him. He is the true vine. If they break away from him, they will be like unproductive branches, and they won't bear fruit. They will then have to be pruned. So what can we make of this analogy? How do we apply this to our daily lives? I have only 2 points to make this morning, and the first one is this. We are to bear fruit. And the second one follows naturally. We must abide in him. Jesus is the vine and we are the branches. And it's our job to bear fruit. Now, a grapevine is a most productive plant. Spreading out its branches, each one is intended to bring forth fruit. No vine dresser in his right mind is foolish enough to invest his time and his effort in growing vines simply because they produce pretty leaves. The farmer looks for results, for fruit, for grapes. as the branches of Christ in the kingdom of God, you and I are supposed to, expected to produce the fruits of the Spirit. And I'm not talking about spiritual apples, pears, and peaches this morning. I'm talking about the fruit of the Spirit, the results of our life of being connected to Jesus. St. Paul spoke about the fruit of the Spirit in his letter to the Galatians. He said, "The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy, peace, patience, it's kindness and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." How's that for a fruit basket? Well, let me ask you this. Let me ask you, what's growing in your orchard? Now, the truth is, we can't produce a healthy harvest of spiritual fruit unless we, the branches, remain connected to the vine. We must abide. We must hold firm, stay close to Jesus. We need to maintain a vital, healthy relationship with Jesus our Lord. Now, on our own, we can do a few good things, but we will not live up to the Christian life which God intends for us. We won't live up to our potential, to who Christ expects and wants and needs us to be, unless we stay connected to Christ our Savior. I once heard a story about a 5-year-old boy who fell out of bed. His cry woke up the whole household. Now, his mother came to the room and comforted him, and she put him back into bed and tucked him under the covers. And as he started to fall asleep, she asked him, "Why did you fall out of bed? What happened?" And in between sobs and tears, he said, "Well, I guess I went to sleep too close to where I got in." Well, far too many Christians make the same mistake. They fall out of the bed of life and then go to heaven, yet they slept too close to where they got in. Oh, they knew Jesus. They got saved, if you will. But they never grew in the likeness of Christ. They stayed exactly where they began the spiritual journey. Let me put it another way. They didn't know the difference between union and communion. Allow me to explain what I mean. Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches." So when you trust Christ, you become a branch in this vine. That is union. We're connected. Union. But then Jesus goes on to say, "The one who abides in me and I in that person, they will bear much fruit." Now that is communion. Union, the connection, is the basis for communion. To abide in Christ is a 24-hour a day, 7-day a week, 52-week a year, intimate relationship with Him, so that we become a fruit-bearing branch. Communion, then, is partaking of Christ and incorporating Him into who you are, allowing Him to transform you. It's not just eating bread and drinking juice. It's a living relationship. Another story. A man tells about a time in his neighborhood when there was a terrible thunderstorm and lightning struck a tree. The wind tore off several branches, several limbs from that particular tree, and it took his neighbor a few days to have the limbs cut up and removed. He made this observation. He said there was something very noticeable about the limbs lying there on the ground, torn from the trunk of the tree. He said they died. He said, now this may sound trite, and you might be thinking, well, of course they did. A branch can't live cut off from the tree. But it was then that it really, really hit me. He said, I know that fact, but seeing them lying dead drilled home the reality that apart from the tree, that limb is not going to survive. It's not going to thrive. And I understood what Jesus was talking about. My friends, we cannot live the Christian life and be fruitful Christians apart from Christ, any more than those branches torn off from the trunk of the tree can continue to live and thrive and produce fruit. Every branch draws its identity, its sustenance, and its very life from the vine. So how do we abide in Christ? You know the answer. It's time spent in prayer, right? On a regular basis. It's reading God's word, and I would say especially reading the gospels, the teachings of Jesus. It's participating in worship on a regular basis. Not occasionally when it's convenient, but on a regular basis. We abide in Christ when we partake of the sacraments, both of them, baptism and Holy Communion. Abide in Christ and allow Christ to abide in you. Allow Jesus to permeate your life, to marinate your soul with love, and to saturate your being with his presence. My friends, if we practice the spiritual disciplines, then people will recognize that we are one of Jesus' followers by the fruit of our lives. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
It has been a very quiet week in terms of prayer concerns. We do want to continue to pray for all of those persons who have been sick, who have been in the hospital, who are now home recovering, for those recovering from surgery, those recovering from the COVID virus, and all of those people on our prayer list. But no new concerns have come my way this week. Lord, hear our prayers. Would you join with me in singing happy birthday to all of our Lakewood friends having birthdays this coming week? Gracious God, dresser of vines, we confess that we have been more willing to consume the fruits of others than to bear fruit ourselves. We have refused to give of ourselves when the harvest seems uncertain, and we ourselves have not always been fruitful because we depended too much on ourselves and not enough on you. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to be channels for your grace. May we be branches who feed on your life-giving spirit and thus bear the fruit of your word in love and in joy. God of all people, we come before you this day as Lakewood United Methodist Church, calling your holy blessing upon us. As we give our lives to you, we ask that you show us your ways. Where there is sickness, bring healing. Where there is hurt, bring comfort. Where there is separation, bring forth reconciliation. O God, who knows us by name, at this time we lift our own concerns to you at this moment. Hear us and answer us, not according to the poverty of our asking, but according to the richness of your grace and love. May we hold all those prayer concerns before the Lord at this time. We give you thanks, eternal God, for providing for all our real needs, material and spiritual, and above all, for granting us in your divine Son a model of a life lived with you and for you. Jesus is a friend who sticks closer than a brother or sister. We thank you for our creation, our preservation, and our salvation. O God, we are thankful far beyond the power of words. We pray all these things in his precious name. Amen. And now may we pray together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hear these words, as recorded in the book of Hebrews. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Let us sing the doxology as we bring to God our gifts and our offerings.
Praise God, draw new all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures hear.
Most gracious and giving God, you have blessed us in mighty ways. Accept this offering of your people. Remember in your love those who have brought it and those for whom it is given. And so follow it with your blessing that it may promote peace and goodwill among people everywhere. And thus advance the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In his holy name we pray. Amen. Remember the words of Jesus when he said, I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me bears much fruit. Go forth in the peace of the Lord and bear much fruit. Amen.